So after a long series of lectures on constraint-based modeling and metabolic networks, we will now move towards gene regulatory networks. We will particularly look at logical models or Boolean networks in today's video. So welcome back. Today we will look at modeling gene regulatory networks. There are many ways to model gene regulatory networks or how metabolism is regulated, and one of the examples we already saw was regulated flux balance analysis. Today we look particularly at Boolean network modeling. So to recap, any network needs to be defined by its nodes and edges. In this case, we will have a directed network. So in a gene regulatory network, the nodes are genes and the edges represent interactions or modulations, and you have directed interactions because you have a gene can repress another gene or a gene can activate another gene and so on. And you can also have self loops. So you can also have self loops in gene regulatory networks. So this is how a gene regulatory network is usually derived. So you have some interactions happening in the metabolic space, some interactions happening in the protein space. So you have a protein that complexes with another protein and then, you know, maybe acts as a transcription factor for another gene and so on and so forth. Finally, this is how the gene regulatory network looks like. If you project all the interactions to the gene space, you say that gene 1 inhibits gene 2 or represses gene 2, gene 2 inhibits gene 4, gene 4 and gene 3 activate gene 2, and so on and so forth. So how do you model these kinds of systems? So you need to first understand all the underlying parts. Right. So make a list of all the parts of the network and make a list of all the interactions of the network, and then qualify and if possible quantify the interactions. This is almost like filling out an adjacency matrix. Right. So if you just fill ones and zeros, it's sort of qualitative. If you can actually say this is going to be like 0.99, this is going to be -0.3, it will end up being quantitative, and you have to reconstruct this from literature and from experiments and so on and so forth. So there are many different classes of models that can be used. So in this slide I try to list many of them. So the most useful paradigm is that of logical modeling, where there are Boolean networks, probabilistic Boolean networks, and tools such as MetaReg, and there are also Petri nets which have been used in the past. And continuous models is something that you already know. So you can have continuous linear models, ordinary differential equations, piecewise linear models, and so on. Regulatory flux balance analysis is something we've done in a previous class. And you can also have stochastic algorithms. So there's Gillespie stochastic simulation algorithm, which is very popular, and there are approximations to Gillespie's algorithm. So we are not really looking at stochastic because most stochastic models are very small. Stochastic models, stochasticity itself becomes important when you have very few numbers of interacting molecules, right? So when the probabilities of interaction or the numbers of molecules becomes more important than concentrations and rates. So what are logical models? So logical models actually belong in a discrete modeling framework. So it's easily translated from the knowledge of qualitative interactions, and of course you will get qualitative insights into regulatory network function. And the temporal development of a system is assumed to happen in discrete time intervals. So meaning you have a snapshot of the system at t equal to 0, then at t equal to 1, at t equal to 2, and so on. And you can sort of make a relationship between how the state of the system at t equals 1 or 2 depends on the state of the system at t equals 0 or 1 and so on and so forth. So there are what are known as Boolean transfer functions that encode relationships between the different variables or the different states. So the temporal development is often assumed to be synchronous or asynchronous. Let's just see what this is. So you basically have a of t, right? Or you can say a of even t plus 1 is f of a of t, b of t, c of t, and so on. So this is almost like a Markovian. No, you have just one piece of memory that you are, one time step that you are talking about, right? So a of t direct t plus 1 directly depends on a of t. So this is called synchronous. You can also have asynchronous, where a of t plus 1 is or is dependent on f of a of t dash, where t dash belongs to t minus 1 or t or even t plus 1. Usually we only look at t or t plus 1, meaning, so what does this mean? When I say a of t plus 1 or b of t, a of t plus 1 depends on, let us say a of t plus 1 What does this mean? The effect of B, the change in B is instantaneous, right? Whereas, you know, in this case, you always have one time step for anything to take effect. No. So, whenever B has changed, so the B of T plus 1 immediately affects A of T plus 1. So, the effect of change in B is instantaneous for A. And so on. So, this is what we say here. So, yeah, here instead of t plus 1 and t, I have t and t minus 1, but it is basically the same, right. And you can also expand this if you want, there is no real restriction. You can have any kind of discrete modeling framework where, you know, you can have something that depends on t minus 10 for all you want, right. So, if you know that something is very slow, it is going to take 10 steps for it to take effect. So, that can be integrated, right. So, how do you set up these rules? That becomes the next question. Let us look at a simple example. So, the first thing we assume is that every node is only in two states. It is either on or off, basically 1 or 0, right. And all the state transitions obey the Boolean regulation functions, or what we translate to Boolean transfer functions, right. So, can you tell me what is this function? So, this is basically a truth table which says what happens to B as a function of A and C. So, B is C. So, you can essentially write this as, we normally try to write down the rules in this fashion. We say to denote the update, we say a star. So, B star equals C, right. And here A star equals not B. And what about C star? So, now given this, you can immediately figure out how the state transitions happen. So, let us say we start at 0, 0, 0. Maybe I will reorder the rules, it will be easier for us. Right. So, A star is not B, B star is C and C star is A. Right. So, what does 0, 0, 0 transit to?
0, 0.
Right. So, you basically negate the second one and copy the third and the first, right. That is what we are doing, right. So, you take C as is and put here, and this you negate it and put here. And is that right? So, now let us do the same thing. So, it will again become 1, zero, 1, right. It will now become 1, 1, 1, right. So, let us just, and what is the next step? 0, 1, 1, and the next step would be 0, 1, 0, and the next step would be 0, 0, 0, which is basically the same as this, right. So, so, you have a cycle of length 6, So what are the things that we do not see here? I think we do not see a 0, 1, 1. So let us see what happens to 0, 1, 1. 0, 1, 1 would become 0, or 0, 1, 1 is there. What is it that we do not see here? 0, 0, 1. So 0, 0, 1 would become a 1, 1, 0, which will become 0, 0, 1, which is essentially the same as this. So you have a cycle of length 2. You can also call these attractors, right. You can have a point attractor or a cycle attractor. This would be a point attractor, this would be a cycle attractor. So how many states do we have? We will have 2 to the n, here it is 8 possible states. So we have uncovered what happens to each of the 8 possible states. What is the next step? So in fact you can visualize this even with something like cytoscape. All you need to do is you just compute the edges like this. So you make a file of this sort, you say 0 0 1 1 1 0 1 1 0 0 0 1, then 0 0 0 1 0 0 1 0 0 1 0 1 and so on, right. So all you need is to create a file with to the n lines for each initial condition, and then you can immediately, so once you visualize it in cytoscape you will be able to see all the how the changes are happening and so on, and you can immediately see how many point attractors are there or cycle attractors are there and so on. There are better ways to find it, but it is just easy to visualize it using cytoscape. So the global state of the model is the combination of all node states. So this is a state, 0 0 is a state, so we see the same thing here, right. So 1 0 0 goes to 1 0 1 and so on, exactly what we just calculated. So the Boolean transfer functions can relate the nodes using various Boolean operators like AND, OR, NOT, you can have AND, NOT, whatever you want. I hope this lecture gave you a good overview of logical models, particularly Boolean networks. How do you set up Boolean transfer functions and so on to model a simple gene regulatory network. In the next video, we will look at a few classic examples of Boolean networks.